If you're working on a more complex project based around a microcontroller, like this alarm clock right here, then you might have noticed that precisely timed events are mandatory. For example, the seconds counter has to count up to exactly 60 seconds before increasing the minutes counter. Or the 2BLZ date of the clock should blink every half second. Or the LED matrix ticker should move one step to the right every quarter second, while the rows of the LED matrix are simultaneously multiplexed at a frequency of 82 Hz. All of those time events, and even generating a PWM signal with variable frequency in order to create an alarm sound, require so-called timers. And it doesn't matter whether you use an MSP430 microcontroller, or a PIC microcontroller, or the Atmega328P microcontroller commonly found on the Arduino Uno. They all feature timers. So in this video, let's have a closer look at the timers of the Atmega328P, learn the basics of how to create precisely timed events, and ultimately create a small circuit that spits out a PWM signal with variable duty cycle and frequency, which goes up to 8 MHz. Let's get started. First off, let's take a look at a very simple Arduino sketch example. Here we pull digital pin 3 high, wait for 1000 milliseconds or 1 second, pull the digital pin low and wait for another second. After uploading the codes and connecting a LED with resistor to the pin, we can see that in fact it blinks every second, which definitely counts as a time event. But there are two problems. Firstly, if I would add a push button as an input to the circuit and edit the code so that the LED would stay off if I press it, we can see that the input gets most of the time ignored by the microcontroller. The reason for that is that the command execution is most of the time stuck inside the delay function, and thus ignores the input commands. And the second reason is that while the delay function promises a waiting time of 1 millisecond, we can see that over longer periods of time, this value drifts off by a couple of milliseconds. So to solve those problems, we can use one of the three timers of the Atmega328P, which, as we can see in the block diagram of the microcontroller, are more like peripherals, which means the microcontroller's command execution sets them up only one time, and then they do their job continuously without clogging up the main code loop. As an example, I will be using the 16-bit timer 1, which certainly offers a lot of useful features. But let's start with the basics, the normal mode. To activate it, we have to set the WGM13, 12, 11 and 10 bits to a 0, which can be found in the TCCR1A and TCCR1B register. So let's simply set all those bits to a 0. But there's one, the CS10 bits, which is responsible for the prescaler, which I will talk about in a second, which we have to set to 1. Now, if I upload the code like this, the TCNT1 register counts up one step each time the 16 MHz clock completes a period. And since the counter is a 16-bit register, we can store 65,536 steps, which means the maximum value is 65,535. After reaching this maximum value, the counter overflows, starts back at 0, counts up again, and repeats this process over and over again. But the most important fact is that when the counter overflows, it sets a so-called overflow flag in the TIFR1 register. That means that by activating the overflow interrupt unable bits in the TIMSK1 register, we can create an overflow interrupt that executes a function each time the counter overflows. In our case, the 16 MHz clock signal would equal 1 second, and thus the maximum register value of 65,535 equals around 4 milliseconds, which was also confirmed by the output of the serial monitor. Now, to increase the time until the overflow occurs, we can use different prescalers to decrease the 16 MHz step duration. For example, If we set the CS12 bit instead of the CS10 bits, we use a prescaler of 256, which means the new overflow time should be around 1.04 seconds, or around 1048 milliseconds, as shown by the serial outputs. Now this time, the interrupt is definitely usable when it comes to blinking an LED, and certainly keeps the main loop responsive to other inputs. But we still didn't create a precise 1 second time event yet. To do that, we could simply increase the start value of the counter register, so that it precisely needs 1 second to reach its maximum value. The formula to calculate the start value looks like this, and to no surprise, it delivers us the required value to create a precise 1 second interrupt. But let's say we need two interrupts, one at 1/4 second and one at 1/2 second. For that, we could use the CTC mode, aka clear timer on compare match mode, which we can activate by setting the WGM12 bits to 1. This time, the counter TCNT1 still counts upwards like usual, but additionally we got two compare registers, OCR1A and OCR1B, whose value get constantly compared to the counter value, and if they match, a compare match flag is triggered, which we can use in the code to create two independent compare match interrupts. But of course only if we set the compare match interrupt enable bits beforehand. It is also mentionable that the top value is not 65,535 anymore. It is the OCR1A value instead. So by using this simple formula, we can calculate a value of 31,249 for the OCR1A register to create the 1/2 second interrupt, and by using the same formula, we can determine a value of 15,624 for the OCR1B register for the 1/4 second interrupt. At this point, I think creating suitable time events is not a problem anymore. So let's move on to the 8-bit fast PWM modes by setting the bits WGM12 and 10 to 1. Additionally, we have to set COM1A1 and COM1B1 to binary 1 as well, to activate the non-inverting output of the OC1A and OC1B pin, which according to the pin mapping of the microcontroller equals pin 9 and 10. Now the functional principle is pretty close to the CTC mode, except that the counter only goes up to an 8-bit value this time, so a maximum of 255. And the output pin OC1A and OC1B pull the output high if a compare match with their register values occurs, and pull the output low when the counter overflows. This way we can vary the register value to create a variable duty cycle, which we can do in a circuit by adding a potentiometer and utilizing the map function. And to reach the highest possible frequency of 62.5 kHz of the PWM signal, we have to utilize the smallest prescaler of 1. Now this PWM signal is already pretty useful for many applications, but we can do even better by activating a fast PWM mode which uses the ICR1 register as the top value. This register is usually utilized for input capturing, but here we can sacrifice it to vary the top value between 0 and 255 by adding a second potentiometer and thus vary the frequency up to 8 MHz, while still being able to adjust the OCR1A value in the higher frequency areas. And with that being said, you are now familiar with the basics of timers. But feel free to read the 100 pages of the Atmega 32-8P datasheet dedicated to timers to learn even more. As always, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.